In the last episode, I showed you the incredible musical keyboard for the Commodore 64. In this episode, I'm going to show you how I installed the SID to SID board into my Commodore 64 in order to get stereo sound with 6 voices. The board does not come with any components populated, so you have to buy them yourself. Fortunately, the instructions are pretty clear about what components you will need. The most unusual and expensive part you're going to need is this wire wrap style dip socket. Now, you could probably order all of these from an electronics distributor. In fact, I live just a few miles from one of the nation's largest, Mauser Electronics. But this time, I decided to try buying all of these parts from eBay. I bought nearly all of the parts from a single seller on eBay. That way, I was able to get combined shipping, so all of the parts ended up costing me about $20. But I did end up with enough parts to build at least 5 of these things, because most of the eBay listings require that you get a handful of whatever part you need. Of course, that can be a good thing if you're prone to messing up and need spares. So I started the build by inserting the long-legged socket for SID number 1. Soldering these things is time consuming, but it's actually really easy. Once the sockets were done, there were just a few components remaining to be finished with the whole thing. Okay, so this next capacitor actually matters which direction it goes. You can see it's labeled with positive and negative signs. The negative is indicated by the stripe down the side of the capacitor. The transistor took a bit of thought for me, and it helped to reference this diagram.
But with the silk screen on the opposite side of the board, it did make it confusing.
Okay, so at this point the board was finished except for the filter caps.
And I didn't know which filter caps to use until I knew what kind of SID chips I was going to be using. And that brings up the other dilemma. You see, there's 2 types of SID chips.
There's the 6581, which runs at 12 volts, and the 8580, which runs at 9 volts. Now, typically the older style breadbin uses the 6581, while the newer style 64C uses the 8580, as well as the Commodore 128.
So you cannot mismatch SID chips in this thing. Whatever type of chip you use in socket 1, you have to use the exact same type of chip in socket 2.
So my plan was to use this Commodore 64C, since I had 2 of them and one of them was broken and won't power on.
So I figured I could salvage the SID chip from the broken 64C.
So I began the process of disassembling the broken unit. Ah, and there's the precious SID chip. Before going any further, I thought it prudent to test this chip by putting it in the working machine, unaltered, and see if it had sound. So I got to repeat this process all over again. And we've arrived at this SID chip. Time to pull it out and insert the second one. Next, I put the computer just enough back together to run the testing program built into the Messiah cartridge.
All right, let's try it. Well, that's a good sign. Let's go to diagnostics, audio.
But there was a problem.
No sound from any of the 3 voices. The chip was dead. Just to make sure I wasn't crazy, I put the original SID chip back in there to test it again.
All right, so I've got the original SID chip back in, and it seems to work.
So that was the end of plan A. I had no more 8580 SID chips available. Well, that's not entirely true. There is one inside my working Commodore 128, but I'm not about to scrap this thing just to take the SID chip out of it. So on to plan B.
I have a working breadbin C64, which you saw in my last video. I thought I might have a spare somewhere in the attic. I have crates full of old computers up there. Some are working, many are not. I dug out an old crummy looking C64. This sucker has seen better days, that's for sure. After a brief test, I confirmed that this unit would not power up.
So, time to salvage its SID chip.
After taking it apart, there was a problem. In this particular unit, Commodore didn't put any sockets for any of the chips. They're soldered directly to the logic board.
This was going to be a monumental pain to get this thing out. And there was no guarantee it was even going to work.
So first, I had to unsolder and remove the RF shield from the bottom, and then I began the laborious process of desoldering the chip. It took about 25 minutes to finally get all of the pins free, and it felt like such a victory to see that chip come out of the board. But the big question to be answered was, did it work? So, much like before, I removed the SID chip from the working C64 and tried this one.
Success! All three voices work fine.
So then I could go ahead and install my filter cap since I knew which type of SID I was going to be using.
I also needed a way to hear sound from SID number 2. Now my plan was to put an additional RCA jack on the back of the Commodore 64.
I did a similar modification to a Casio keyboard by drilling holes in the case and using panel mount RCA jacks. This same process should be just as easy on the C64 as there's plenty of extra space on the back of the case. But for the meantime, I just wanted a way to test the SID to SID, so I took a spare RCA cable like this. I have a box full of them. So I just cut the end off and stripped the end and soldered it right to the board. The last step was to attach the chip select wire. The purpose of this wire is to tell the second SID chip when it is being accessed by the CPU because it's mapped to a different memory address than the first one. It connects to this pin on the cartridge board. So I popped in the two SID chips and I was about to make C64 history, except I ran into one more problem. This metal cage for the video chip was in the way. This was so annoying. I had come this far and nothing in the documentation said anything about this.
Of course, different Commodore 64s had different arrangements on the logic board, so it's possible maybe mine is a less common configuration, but either way around, I had to do something about it. So, you know, the shield is there primarily to meet FCC regulations on RF emissions, so I theoretically could remove it.
But I wanted to keep it because the top lid also acts like a heat sink to keep the video chip cool. So I decided to do some modifications. I used cutters and pliers to snip off and remove a chunk of the sidewall, and then I took a Dremel to the top piece and cut a perfect sized chunk out. I gave it some new thermal grease and put it back together and everything fit perfectly.
Unfortunately, it still didn't work. I got sound from SID number 1, but no sound from SID number 2.
Upon closer examination, I discovered I had been a bonehead and put the transistor in backwards. So, I desoldered and threw it in the trash in case I damaged it, and I used one of those spares I told you about. I put in the new transistor and tried it again, and lo and behold, it worked.
Alright, well I hope you enjoyed that. You'll have to wait till the next episode for me to explore the Messiah cartridge so that I can show you better usage of the dual SID chip. I would also like to point out, although this was a huge pain and it took nearly 2 days to complete this task, a lot of it was poor planning on my part. I should have had a dual SID configuration tested and ready before the card even got here. Maybe even bought a SID chip online, that might have made things a bit easier. Anyway, I will see you next time.